Good morning and very warm welcome indeed to service here in the East today, and especially if you're visiting us, we do welcome you. Hope you feel at home here amongst us, and join us for tea or coffee in the hall just behind after the service. There's just two or three intimations to highlight. The prayer meetings are the usual times of 1 p.m. and 7:30. All very welcome, of course. Next weekend, we have our quarterly communion. Donald Morrison will conduct the communion service on Sunday, and Reverend David Scott will conduct the preparatory service on Friday. That's 7:30. And could I just remind elders that the Kirk session meets before this service on Friday at 6:45. So it's 6:45, a little bit earlier than our usual custom. Yesterday we had a very successful and very pleasant soup and sandwich lunch which the girls' brigade laid on. And I've got a little note which Gemma has given me about this. On behalf of the girls' brigade, Gemma writes, on behalf of the parents' committee, we'd like to say a huge thank you to all who supported the soup and sandwich lunch yesterday. We had a great day and were overwhelmed by the support from both our congregation here at the East and also the congregation at Inches. The total amount raised was £687.55. So a huge thank you to all who supported us. The money will go far in helping our Girls Brigade division. Also, there's some baking left over, so please come and have some leftovers, which are very, very nice with your tea after the service. So thanks, Gemma. Could I also just say that Inches, or Inches East as we will be, are very supportive indeed towards the Girls' Brigade. And a large number of the congregation came down yesterday. Just in regard to the union with Inches East, the processes, the wheels are turning. And really the date is largely in the hands of the general trustees in Edinburgh. So we're just waiting. And there could be, we could have an answer for a date of union by next week, possibly, just possible. So sorry we can't give you a definite time. I think the Press and Journal suggested that it might be December this year, but this isn't the case at all. This Kirk session are still looking towards a date of union in March, this March. And lastly, just a word of welcome once again to Donald Morrison, who's conducting a service. And we do look forward, as always, to Donald's word to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Donald. It's good to see you all, and I trust, as always, that the Lord will bless us as we worship him together. Our call to worship is from Psalm 66. Shout with joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing praise to your name. Well, let us sing praises to God's name in Psalm 107, verses 1 to 9. Praise God, for he is good, for still his mercies lasting be. Let God's redeemed say so, whom he from the enemy's hand did free, and gathered them out of the lands from north, south, east, and west. They strayed in desert's pathless way, no city found to rest. Psalm 107, verses 1 to 9. Praise God, for he is good.
Thank you.
Shall we come before the Lord in prayer? Oh, that men to the Lord would give praise for his goodness then, and for his works of wonder done unto the sons of men. Eternal and ever blessed Lord, we gather on this Lord's Day morning to worship you, to thank you for your goodness and your grace and your mercy extended in so many different ways towards us. And we thank you, O Lord, that we can gather today safely in the presence of a God who cares for us so much that you sent your dear Son into this world in order to free us, in order to redeem us, in order to break down the barrier of separation between sinful humanity on the one side and a holy God on the other side. And Lord, we acknowledge when we look back over the years that we have often gone our own way and sought our own satisfactions without giving any thought whatsoever to you or to the things of eternity. But Lord, we bless you that you are not like us, that you are the God who thinks of his people, the God who delights in his people, the God who sings praises over his people, the God whose ear is ever inclined to the pleas and the petitions of his people, the God who is ever at work, working out his eternal purposes as he gathers to himself a church and as he gathers people, as we've been singing there, from the lands, from the north, the south, the east, and the west. And that did not just happen, O Lord, in biblical times, but by your Holy Spirit, you are ever at work every single day, 24/7. And as your word is read and as it is faithfully preached on this Lord's Day from one corner of the world to another, we pray that there would be a mighty outburst of rejoicing in the presence of the angels over a multitude of men, women, and boys and girls, saved sinners, taken from the kingdom of darkness, plucked from the devil's hand, and brought into the glorious light and liberty of the Lord Jesus Christ, brought into the kingdom to know the one who is the light of the world, the one who says, I am the way, not one way amongst many, but the one who says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And we know that because we do approach you, O God, this day through your Son, we know that we will not be turned away from the throne of grace, but you will receive us. And we pray that we would indeed seek to bless your name, seek to honor you, O Lord. Forgive us if sometimes we sing the well-known words of hymns and psalms in a mechanical way, but help us, O Lord, to sing from the very depths of our being with thankfulness for all that you have done for us and will continue to do for us. Lord, we bless you for bringing us here today. We thank you, Lord, for the peace that surrounds us. We thank you for health and for strength. We thank you for families. We thank you for loved ones. We thank you for all the many good gifts that we often take so much for granted. But Lord, when we look around us in the world and we see the suffering of so many, we have so much to thank you for. We thank you, Lord, for the gospel. We think of our ancestors here in ancient Caledonia, living in fear and in dark superstition. And we thank you that you sent your servants hundreds and hundreds of years ago who came here and brought the light of the gospel. And we thank you that since those days, hundreds of years ago, that many have gone out from Scotland, men and women, taking the gospel with them to all the corners of the world. And we know, Lord, that there are so many people in Africa and India and in other parts of the world who give thanks today for Scottish missionaries, British missionaries, who brought the light of the gospel to their forefathers many years ago. Lord, we look upon our own nation today, a nation that is turning its back upon you, a nation that is forsaking the fountain of living water, which is the true God. A nation, O Lord, that is embracing lifestyles and ways that are an abomination to you. And we ask, O Lord, that you would forgive us for our many, many sins. We long that you would open wide the windows of heaven and pour out the dew of the Holy Spirit upon the dry, parched land of Scotland, that you would revive us, that you would restore us, that we would once again be the nation of whom the psalmist says, blessed is that nation whose God is the Lord. And Lord, we thank you that you are the one true and living God, a God who has revealed himself to us, a God who has come to us in the person of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. So Lord, bless all of your people today. Bless each family represented here amongst us. Remember especially any who are troubled or anxious or burdened in any way. Remember those who are mourning the passing of loved ones. Remember those who are anxious about their health or the health of family members and friends. And we commend them all to you, O God. Remember the interim moderator. Remember David. Bless him and be with him with the extra duties and responsibilities that have devolved upon him at this time. And be with the elders, be with the deacons, be with everybody who plays a role in the life of this church. We thank you for them all, for those who work the electronics, for the organists, for those who do the tea and the hospitality, for those who clean the church, for the one who cleans the church, for those who greet visitors at the door. Lord, we thank you for every single one of them, and we ask that you would bless them. So be with us now and bless us as we gather to focus upon your word and to meditate upon it. Be with us as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples and taught us also, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Forgive me for looking up and reading, but I have a habit of saying the Lord's Prayer in the manner that we said it in school in London many years ago, and it's a slightly different version, so I don't like to confuse people. So I wonder if the kids could come to the front. Any more kids? Yeah, I'm seeing some shadows flitting past. It's a long journey from up there, isn't it? And here's another big kid coming. He obviously feels the cold. He's wearing his fur coat. Well, boys and girls, I like to walk along riverbanks because I go fishing sometimes, and when I'm walking along the riverbank or where I'm walking along a beach beside the sea, I like to pick up attractive stones. And this is a stone I picked up beside the River Findhorn a few years ago, and I think it's a type of rock known as granite. It's a grey granite. This is another stone I picked up, and it's got a lovely pink colour, pink and grey. And this one here, this is beautiful. This is made of a stone known as quartzite, and it's perfectly white. And if you come into my house, on one of the window ledges, there's lots of different colored stones, and they're very, very attractive. And when people come into my house, you know, they'll say, oh, those are nice stones. Where did you get them? But I want to show you another stone, and I want to ask you, do you think that this is a beautiful attractive stone in the same way that this one is? No, you don't think this is an attractive stone. So if I gave you this stone, you wouldn't put it on your window ledge or your mantelpiece. What would you do with it? Just throw it in the bin? No? Put it outside in the garden, perhaps. Use it as a doorstop, couldn't you? Well, yeah, it's a very dull-looking stone. It's a I wouldn't want that stone on my mantelpiece or on my window ledge. But you know, looking at this stone and the fact that it's not very attractive reminds me that some books are not very attractive either. You see this book, this is a Bible, and I don't know why, but Bibles in the old days were always had a black cover. And if I go into somebody's house and I look at the books in their bookcase, and I saw a book like this with a dull black cover, I would say to myself, this can't be an interesting book. This must be a very dull and boring book, because look at the cover. There's no color, there's no pictures whatsoever. But there's an old saying that says you should never judge a book by its cover. And see this stone here? It's very, very dull, but somebody a long time ago took a special saw and they cut through the stone, and when you look inside it, it's quite different, isn't it? It's very beautiful. So when I have this stone on my window ledge at home, that's not the bit that people see, but they see this bit here, which is in the middle. You can have a closer look at it if you want. It's beautiful, isn't it? It is crystals. Yeah, you're quite right. These are crystals that have formed a long, long time ago. And so it's not very attractive on the outside, but on the inside, it's very beautiful. And that's just how the Bible is. Yes, it's a bit dull on the outside, but inside, it's beautiful because it's the most wonderful book in the world. This is God's love letter to you and to me. And you know that God has a special love for young people. And people, we're told in the Bible that when children were coming to Jesus, the disciples were trying to push them away. Don't bother Jesus. He's very important. He's got no time for you children. And Jesus said not to do that. He wanted children to come to him because he has a special love for Jesus. And that's one of the many wonderful things that we read about in the Bible. Yes, it has a dull cover, but it's what's inside that's important. And it tells us all about God, and it tells us all about what God has done for you and for me, that he loves us so much that he has given us that which is most precious to him, and that's his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So thank you for listening. And we're now going to sing in Mission Praise 627, Teach Me to Live Day by Day in Your Presence, Lord. Day by day in Your Presence, Lord, teach me to live. And of course, if we want to know how to live in a way that's pleasing and honoring to God, then we must read our Bibles, and your Sunday school teachers will tell you all about that. So we sing Mission Praise 627. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again, acknowledging that every good and perfect gift comes from your lavish hand. And we thank you so much for your generosity towards us. And help us to be generous back. And we pray that you would take this money, that you would use it, O Lord, for the furtherance of your kingdom, for the building up of your church, and for reaching out into Scotland and the world to tell people the wonderful gospel about the Lord Jesus Christ. So use this money, we ask, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our reading this morning, and it'll be the same next Sunday as well, is Ephesians chapter 2, and that's page 1174. And Bill will read and lead us in our prayer of intercession.
As Donald has just said, page 1174, if you're using the Pew Bible. We're reading from Ephesians chapter 2 and reading from verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Therefore, remember that formerly you, who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And to him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Amen. And we now come before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for another opportunity to come before you at this time of public worship. We give thanks for the scripture we have just read, that we were once dead in our trespasses and sins, but because of your great love for us, and you being rich in mercy, have brought us near to you through the blood of Christ. We pray that we would always remember and value how much has been done for each one of us. We pray at this time for the many trouble spots in our world. We continue to pray for the situation in Ukraine. We pray that peace would come to that troubled area, and we pray for the many civilians who are caught in the middle of the conflict. We pray that you would protect them. We pray for the leadership of the country and all the military personnel. Many have already given their lives for their country, and we commit to you all the families they have left behind. Give them a sense of your comfort and protection. We pray too for the countries, including our own country, who are trying to help by providing equipment to Ukraine. Give them wisdom and guidance to help without escalating the problem. We pray for and commit to you too the situation in Afghanistan, where the country's rulers are reverting to more and more draconian measures. These are causing hardship in various ways and making it almost impossible for the aid agencies to work effectively. We pray that you would open their eyes to see the suffering and poverty they are inflicting on their own people. At home, we continue to pray for the NHS at this time as they endeavour to deal with the many patients awaiting operations and procedures. We give thanks for the hard work of the staff, surgeons, doctors and nurses as they continue to work. Give them strength in mind and body as they continue. Difficulties arise because of shortage of staff and staff sickness because of the stress they are working under. We pray that the politicians of the United Kingdom would strive to find a way to improve the conditions the staff are working under. We pray too at this time for those who are ill. We commit them to you and pray that they would find comfort in knowing that you are a gracious God and loving Heavenly Father who cares for each one of us. We pray too for those who have been bereaved. We commit them into your loving care. We take comfort from the words of our Lord Jesus that they will be comforted. We pray for the Church of Scotland, both at national and local level. At this time of much change, we pray for the leadership of the Church. We pray that you would grant them wisdom and discernment. We pray for ourselves here at East Church as we work through all the practical things that need to be done as a congregation in view of the impending merger with Inch's Church. Give us guidance and wisdom as we prepare for all the adjustments. We pray for and commit to you the children who have gone through to Sunday school. We pray for each one, the importance of each one, as Jesus reminded us, for such is the kingdom of God. We pray too for each one attending the Girls' Brigade. Bless each one. We give thanks for the support that was shown by various congregations in their fundraising yesterday. We give thanks for the teachers of the Sunday School and Girls' Brigade and pray that you would encourage each one in the work they do. We pray for the children of the Sunday School and those of the Girls' Brigade as they prepare for the adjustments that were made as they locate to Inch's Church. Be with them as they settle into their new surroundings. We give thanks for the Reverend Donald Morrison's availability to open up the scriptures to us. And as we listen, we remember the words of the Apostle Paul to Timothy. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness. We pray that we would all benefit from the message to us this morning. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Bill. We sing now in Mission Praise 279, I Know Not Why God's Wondrous Grace to Me Has Been Made Known. Know why, unworthy as I am, he claimed me for his own. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Mission Praise 279, I know not why, God's wondrous grace. We turn again to the passage of Scripture we read in Paul's letter to the Ephesians in chapter 2, and we'll read again from verse 8. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works. On the surface, Christianity appears to be like many other religions, in common with Judaism, for instance, and Islam. We worship one God. We have our holy scriptures sharing the Old Testament with Jews. We each have our services, we have our creeds, we have our festivals, we have our liturgies and much else besides. And we have a belief in an afterlife and a desire to enter heaven or paradise when our time here on earth is complete. But these are all outward similarities. And I remember hearing somebody or reading about somebody many years ago, and they were concerned that people of different religions didn't come together. And they came up with this notion that if you took the best parts of each religion and put them all together, we'd have this wonderful religion of peace where everybody would be able to get on together. Well, I can certainly go along with taking the good parts of Christianity, which is all of Christianity, but I'm not sure about the others. But there is one thing that separates Christianity from all other religions, and that is grace, the grace of God. The world is filled with countless millions of people, religious people, who are trying hard to gain entry into heaven. And whether they go via long and arduous pilgrimages, whether it's via charitable work, self-denial, regular church attendance, prayer vigils, or whether they go via an act of suicide that destroys what they believe to be the enemies of God, the object is the same, a place in paradise, the joy of heaven forevermore. But the Bible contradicts such beliefs because it emphasizes for us unambiguously that no one can work their way into heaven. It is simply not possible, no matter how hard they try. If we could, it would mean that God would be in our debt. He would be obliged to let us in because of our good works. But God is no man's debtor. A fellow minister, a friend of mine, was speaking to a Muslim on a flight from London to Inverness on one occasion, and the Muslim was telling him that his hope for the future, when he came to the end of life's journey, was that he would be weighed in the scales, and he had these imaginary scales, and all his good works would be in one pan of the scales, and his not-so-good works would be on the other, and his hope was that his good works would outweigh the bad. But my friend, if you only had one sin, one bad work in that pan, it would outweigh no matter how many good works we had done. We simply cannot work our way into heaven. God is no man's debtor. But God offers us something far superior to our feeble efforts. He offers us free entry into heaven. Salvation at no cost to ourselves. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, we read here. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It is by grace, God's grace from start to finish, a free gift given by the God of all grace. Some churches, and when I was a teenager, I used to go to a Baptist church in London, and some churches push people to make a commitment for Christ. And then perhaps having attended for some months to pre-communion classes, perhaps under emotional pressure, some people think that they are Christians, and then they can say, well, I gave my life to Jesus. And some of them, I'm glad to say, stay the course, and they do grow in faith, and they do become Christians, but many others fall away. They fall away because they were not truly born again to begin with. And Jesus illustrates such people in the parable of the sower, people who, when they heard the word, they responded with joy, but then the pressures and the worries of this world, you know, came and took precedence. And so the faith that they had quickly passed away. But the simple fact is that we cannot will ourselves to be born again. And Jesus tells us in John 3:16, that in John chapter 3, that unless a man or woman is born again, they shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven. We cannot will ourselves to be born again any more than we could have willed ourselves to have been born physically in the first place at the start of life. Being born again is a divine act. Children born not of natural descent, as John puts it in chapter 1 of his gospel, nor of human decision nor a husband's will, but born of God. And Bill was reading to us in Ephesians, and he focused in his prayer on the fact that, as we read at the very beginning of that chapter, that we were dead in our trespasses and in our sins. That was the condition of the Ephesian Christians, before they came to know the Lord Jesus Christ. They were dead, not physically dead, but not mentally dead, but they were dead spiritually speaking. They lived lives that were disobedient to God. They were pagans. They worshipped pagan so-called gods. Their lives were disobedient to God, gratifying the cravings of the sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts, as we read in verse 2. And we might ask, does Paul only speak of the Ephesians of old? Were they so decadent, were they so degraded that Paul, writing through the Holy Spirit, referred to them as being dead? But in fact, they were no different to the majority of people in the United Kingdom today. That is the biblical diagnosis of fallen humanity in every single age. Without Christ, we are dead. And when God looks at a man or woman who does not have Christ as their Savior, no matter what else they might believe, no matter what other good works they might have done, he's looking at people who are spiritually dead and who are heading for a lost eternity. And verse 12 describes their condition. They are separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. That's a terrible predicament to be in, isn't it? To be without hope and without God in the world. But that describes the majority of people in Scotland today, this land which has known such great outpourings of God's Spirit in times past, is now a desert, a dry, parched land of spiritual impoverishment, a land characterized by God's accusation against his people of old. As we read in Jeremiah, "My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water," or the fountain of living water, "and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water." And I'm sure all of you who are Christians here this morning, you can look back at your pre-Christian life and you can verify just how accurate Paul is in his assessment of how you were before you came to know Jesus. You would acknowledge, I'm sure, that you, like me, lived self-centered lives. We focused on our own pleasures and satisfactions. We may have attended church regularly, but God was not on the throne of our lives. We only paid lip service to him. He had no prominent place in our lives or in our plans. But thanks be to God, he is not like us. He had a prominent role for us as his people, and gladly he does not treat us as we treat him. And because of our indifference towards him, we were, as Paul puts it here in verse 3, we were by nature objects of wrath. We have a God who is a loving God, a loving Father to his children. But until we came to acknowledge his Son Jesus as our Redeemer, as our Savior and Lord, we were objects of God's wrath. And note that Paul here is not just speaking of the Ephesians, he's including himself, religious man as he was, Pharisee as he was, great apostle as he became. Before he met Christ, he was no different to anyone else. He was no different to the former pagans in Ephesus, objects of God's wrath. Why? Because of his transgressions and sins, which alienated him from God and which alienates us from God until we come to know Jesus. In Isaiah 59, "Your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear." The world we live in is full of people with fit, healthy bodies, sharp, active minds, lively personalities, but who are nevertheless dead spiritually, the living dead, who see no beauty in Jesus, whose hearts are not warmed at the thought of God's love, who love neither the Lord nor the Lord's people, who see nothing of the glory of God in his creation. A friend of mine, he's a retired minister, and he's very well known in Free Church circles for, he will come along and he shows some wonderful photographs of birds. He's an ornithologist, And believe it or not, he came to faith in a hide on the moors of Caithness. He was photographing a greenshank. Now, if you want to photograph a greenshank, you've got to get permission from the RSPB because it's a very rare and protected bird. And he was in the hide, one of these camouflage tents. He's looking through his great big lens at this greenshank, and he was seeing the scales on its long legs. And that's why it's called greenshank. It's got long green legs. I hope none of us have got long green legs. But he was seeing the iridescence of the scales on the legs of that bird. And he thought to himself, wait a minute, this bird was created. It was created. It could not have just formed through a long process of evolution. And he came to faith, not necessarily there on that particular moment in that hide, but that was the trigger point that brought him to acknowledge God as the creator of all things, the sustainer of all things, and as his own personal redeemer. Well, the world, as I'm seeing, is full of fit, healthy people who nevertheless, in the sight of God, are dead, the living dead, who see no beauty in Jesus. And that's the great tragedy, isn't it, of fallen humanity. Men and women created by God, created for fellowship with him, and yet who ignore him, who exclude him from their lives. But sadly for them, when life's journey comes to its inevitable end, God will exclude them also from his presence. And when they protest about all the things that they did in life, they will find the door to heaven firmly shut, and they will know the severity of God's wrath, and they will hear those dreadful words, "Depart from me, for I never knew you." And those are words that none of us in this church need ever hear, because for years the gospel has been faithfully preached from this pulpit. Nobody who has attended this church or many of the other evangelical churches in Scotland need ever hear those terrible words, "Depart from me, for I never knew you," because you've heard the gospel. You've had many, many opportunities to reach out by faith, trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we read here in our particular text, it says here, "It is by grace you have been saved. It is by grace you have been saved." And the Christians in Ephesus were in exactly the same predicament, as indeed were all Christians before they came to faith. Before God, as we read in verse 4, God is rich in mercy. Isn't it wonderful that the God we worship, he's rich in mercy. He made us alive. He made us alive even when we were dead in transgressions and sins. And notice the source of the action here. It's not that we became alive, but it was God. God made us alive. Only God can bring life to that which is dead. We cannot will to live because we are dead. And dead people can do nothing. You can clash a pair of cymbals in their ears. You can hit them on the knee with a hammer, but there will be no response. They cannot respond because there is no life in them. And that's a picture of the natural man or woman who is as yet a stranger to God's grace. They're dead in their transgressions and sins, unable even to respond to the preaching of the gospel until the Holy Spirit comes and breathes life into them. And then not only are they unable to respond to the gospel offer of salvation, but they will respond because they're drawn by God's irresistible grace. We might think that people are drawn to put their faith in Jesus against their will, but not so, because when the Holy Spirit comes and works in the heart of a man or woman, an inner change comes about. The old heart of stone is taken away and replaced with a heart of flesh. The scales are removed from their eyes and they begin to see the loveliness of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a wooden plaque on my living room wall, and it's from Song of Solomon. It says, "He is altogether lovely." And it was given to us many, many years ago by my late father-in-law. But of course, we weren't Christians then, so we didn't want to have this biblical text prominently displayed on the wall in our house, and so we put it away in a drawer. We never threw it out. We put it away in a drawer. And then back in 1987, in April 1987, when my late wife Margaret came to faith, the first thing she did was to open the drawer and take out that plaque with those wonderful words that speak of Jesus. He is altogether lovely. And it's had a prominent place in our house ever since. It is by grace that we have been saved. And the natural man or woman is dead in their transgressions and sins until the Holy Spirit comes and quickens them and awakens them. And that person's eyes are opened, and they see two things for the very first time. They see, first of all, the predicament of their sinful condition, and they see the means that God has provided to rescue them from that condition, which is Christ Jesus, who was delivered over to death on the cross, and he was raised to life for our justification, as we read in Romans 4. And then that person, their eyes having been opened, new hearts having been given to them, they see Christ and they run to Christ. They seek forgiveness for all their sins, an act which we simply could not have done had God not first of all made us alive with Christ. And that's why Paul is able to state, it is by grace you have been saved. Not once, but he writes that twice in verse 5 and again in verse 8. And we dishonor God if we somehow imagine that we are responsible for our own salvation because of the good works that we have done. The writer to the Hebrews refers to Jesus as the author and the finisher of our faith. From start to finish, he is the author and finisher of the faith that we have. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. It is a gift, and yet we have to appropriate that gift by faith. We have to reach out with empty hands and accept it, laying aside any dependence upon good deeds or religiosity, casting aside all our pride and coming on our knees to the God of all grace, the God who is rich in mercy, whose love for sinners is so great. And Jesus says of himself, he said, the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. If we weren't lost, then Jesus wouldn't have had to come. But we were lost. He did come, and he has saved his people, not just for this life, but for all eternity. And without Christ, we are as lost and as helpless as a man or woman drifting in the sea, having fallen overboard from a ship, cold and exhausted, or a climber trapped on an icy ledge, his mind gradually becoming befuddled by hypothermia, in need of a rescue from some outside body, or an abandoned baby in a soiled nappy. But thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Jesus came to seek and to save those who were perishing. But now in Christ Jesus, we read, you who once were afar off have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Somebody asked me the other day, what's my favorite verse in Scripture? And that is my favorite verse, chapter 2 of Ephesians, verse 13. But now, regardless of my condition in the past, regardless of how I lived in the past, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were afar off, I who were once afar off, I've been brought near. I didn't come near of my own volition. I've been brought near by the blood of Christ. Christ's death on the cross has brought salvation. Christ's death on the cross has brought redemption. It has brought freedom. It has broken down the barrier of separation between God on the one hand and we on the other. Bypass the cross and you are heading for a lost eternity in the company of millions. One of my good friends, he was training for the Church of Scotland ministry, and he had to do a 20-week placement with a minister in the city where he was studying. And unfortunately for him, my friend is an evangelical. He spent 20 weeks with a very liberal minister who said to him, I hate those churches that are awash with the blood of Christ. I hate those churches that are awash with the blood of Christ. But you know, this church here is awash with the blood of Christ, because the first time I came into this pulpit, I saw this, we preach Christ crucified, the cross of Christ where he shed his precious blood. And again, it's written here, again, we preach Christ crucified, a reminder to any preacher coming into this pulpit, this is what has been preached in this church for years and years, and this is what we still preach here today. We have been brought near by God's divine action, and it's all of God's glorious grace. We deserve hell, but instead God has given us an everlasting inheritance kept in heaven for us. And that should cause us to rejoice. But the amazing thing is, as we study Scripture, is that God rejoices also over his people together with the angelic host. He sent his son to seek and to save. And the wonderful parable of the prodigal son, we see the reaction of the father when the son finally comes back home. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, but he's alive again. He was lost and he is found. That's the predicament. That's the situation of every person who comes to Jesus Christ. We were dead, but we're now alive. We were lost, but we are now found. Let me finish with a passage from Romans 11. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. May the Lord add his blessing to these thoughts and meditations on his word. We come before you, eternal God, acknowledging that before we came to Christ, we too were like the Ephesians of old, dead in our trespasses and sins. But we thank you that by the quickening of your Holy Spirit, your children have been made alive, and we have been enabled by your grace to reach out by faith and to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We reach out with empty hands. And we thank you, O Lord, that you turn away none who truly seek you. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Seek and you shall find. May that be our situation from now on if we are still strangers to your grace. Take away anything said today that's not in conformity with your word. May the glory be yours and the blessings ours. In Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We conclude by singing that wonderful hymn of John Newton, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Thank you.
And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit, one God, rest and remain with you all, now and forever. Amen.